really thankful to be here, duly humble, more humble than maybe before, hearing the people that have preceded this talk and hearing Dean Martoli refer to wisdom, which is not something normally referred to with construction people. But I'd like to thank Dean Martoli and Elizabeth for having me here, and I certainly feel at home because one of your prior directors, Carlo McCarrick, was instrumental in the book project. He read the manuscript in detail 3 times, gave us copious notes, had many long sessions with him about different things that would be better or worse to put in, because he could have written this book, could be that thick, there's so much material. And so it's really his project as much as mine. I know he's been really good to see Paul. So but I might mention what the point of the book, and I might bring some more thing, as the Dean said, I didn't invent the Vatican, but in many ways the Vatican invented me. You can't serve over there in a role like this and get to know so many wonderful leaders of the church, so many wonderful people at the North American College, so many wonderful Italian interlocutors, without being changed radically. And I hope the book is an outproduct of that kind of personal journey for me to have had that opportunity. The reason I wrote the book is because when I was speaking about diplomacy in the Holy See, I found out that many people have very little knowledge of the role the Holy See has played in diplomacy over the years. It's a very important role, and as the Dean alluded to, I think it's more important maybe right now than ever. I'll try to make that point. The other reason I wrote the book is that is to further reinforce the value of the United States' strong diplomatic relationship with the Holy See. There are many, the State Department is a very secular place, and it's very important that that mission, that people understand what that mission is trying to accomplish, and that the people that believe in the mission be ready to support it, which, by the way, is a bipartisan program of all past Holy See ambassadors, Democrat and Republican, as Tom Mullady might have referred to when he was still alive. So the Holy See's role in international affairs is not widely understood. It's the second largest diplomatic representation in the world, following the United States. And they've had non-Catholic diplomats since the Peace of Westphalia in 1648. There are 179 diplomatic representatives accredited to the Holy See, and 30 are from Muslim countries, and only 123 are from Catholic countries. So it's one of the most diverse diplomatic representations in the world as well. One of the smarter guys over there, who was very high in the Secretary of State's office, and many of the priests here may know, Cardinal Talleyrand, gave a pithy quote that kind of summarizes what the Holy See is trying to accomplish by being in the diplomatic business. It says, the Holy See can serve as a moral authority to contest systems or ideas that corrode the dignity of the person, and therefore threaten world peace. And that really says it all. There's a lot of concepts bound up in that that I hope we'll come back to here, is why the Holy See needs to be addressed diplomatically in the world. In many ways, it's a unique one. What do? They do the same thing now that they've done in the past. They nurture respect for human dignity, the natural rights of man, with the Pope at Lampedusa speaking up against opposing the globalization of indifference. They're the only people that can say that with global authority. Speak up against abridgments of freedom, especially religious freedom. Many make the argument that without religious freedom, you can't have the other freedoms that they ensue from religious freedom. And then to defend the need for moral values in civic life and in government architectures. The premise, as Pope Benedict expressed, as secularism. Pope Francis recently in Korea described it as a materialism, that it's basically a confining religion to what happens inside of a building and making it apart from the governing of people's lives and their beliefs as they interact with other human beings. And that's one of the cornerstones of Holy See diplomacy. So the argument is that the Holy See is no less relevant in the modern era than they have been in the past. And now that we face these asymmetrical conflicts where it's not Army 1 and Army 2, and where there's so much religion bound up in the conflicts, you know, whether in the case of radical Islam that religion is being used to propagate hegemony, or whether hegemony is being masked by religion, it doesn't matter, it's all the same thing. And then there's also a lot of conflicts in Africa that are maybe quasi-religious or tribal, in fact. And you see Boko Haram in northern part of Nigeria, problems there. Even the State Department's getting with the program. They're starting to talk about soft power. They have a new program of cultural diplomacy, which is another way of saying soft power, building bridges, the same thing that Pope Benedict did when he tried to reorganize the Council on Culture to make culture a weapon in the fight against radical Islam. And recently the UNASUR nations, the southern part of Latin America, asked the Holy See to mediate in Venezuela. The protest between the students and the Bureau of Government. We could talk about that maybe. So the Holy See exercises something called soft power, the power of influence and persuasion rather than coercion. By trying to build bridges to your adversary, to convince your adversary by the moral probity of your arguments, and to find common areas to work together to take the hard, take some of the hardness out of opposing positions. Being non-territorial, being non-hegemonic, they're unique sovereign. You know, we were talking at lunch that many times when I was serving, the president would say, we really want the Holy See to say this, the State Department, because it sounds so much better than the Pope said, than the U.S. said, you know, what it's about. Angola, okay, where there's all kinds of people jockeying for their oil. Well, obviously, Hamadina jockeying. First thing he'd say is, you just want my oil, that kind of stuff. And so the more aligned the countries can be, the more effective they can be to work together to get that message out. And the other thing is, the Holy See is not really a political organization in the strict sense. I mean, I know there's internal politics and all that, but they're not elected. And as such, they don't have to take credit for what they do. You know, they're trying to get a bridge named after them or something, and like a politician. And that makes them uniquely effective. Some of the greatest things the Holy See has accomplished for humanity go totally without saying, and they have to. I put a couple of things in the book. Fortunately, WikiLeaks allowed. WikiLeaks is a horrible thing, okay? I know a couple of Monsignors whose lives probably were at stake because of the things that would leak cables if we were helping the Monsignors covertly in Venezuela. But on the other side, it certainly helped my book because I put a lot of things in there. WikiLeaks, the State Department never would have let me do that. So to sum up about that, I might mention the Stalin quote that I mentioned in the book where he said after World War II, they were talking about getting the Holy See involved in things. And he said, how many divisions does the Pope have? But the irony is, Stalin's gone, communism's gone, and it was a pope that, as much as anybody else, brought him down. So the United States particularly benefits from this relationship. It's had, we've had many ups and downs in the relationship of the church to the United States. You know, John and Charles Carroll in 1776 were enlisted by Ben Franklin to help go to Canada and try to incite the French to oppose the Quebec Acts. And they didn't want to do that. And of course, Charles Carroll was assigned with the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, but they couldn't vote in the state of Maryland. So Maryland was founded in the 1640s as a Catholic colony, and by 120 years later, Catholics couldn't vote. And most of the colonies in the United States were founded in one form or fashion as religious colonies, just different. So Maryland was the one that we got. And part of that goes back to, I try to make this point in the book, goes back to the Enlightenment, and the new thinkers of the Enlightenment felt that they invented the natural rights of man. Now, how ridiculous is that? That God and Jesus invented the natural rights of man, and the church has been the leading spokesman for the natural rights of man since that time. But the Enlightenment leaders felt that the church was monarchic. They were really kind of like some of the radical Islamicists, really have an enemy of the monarchical Arab states, in addition to hating Western civilization. The Enlightenment scholars really didn't like the European monarchies. And they saw the United States as an opportunity to employ these political theories in a different way. And so they felt they had to move away from the church. When I tried to show them that they're all saying the same thing. And it's unfortunate that a lot of Catholics were prejudiced against in the process. We had a charge d'affaires, which is a second level diplomatic mission, for a few times during the mid-1800s. But no full diplomatic representation until 1983, which I'll get to later. And unfortunately, the relationship's been a little attenuated the last few years. President Obama has not had the interest in leveraging the Holy See's voice that his predecessors, including Bill Clinton, had. Hopefully now, after Secretary Kerry making a couple of visits over there, and President himself making a visit in April, they'll realize that the Holy See's a valuable ally in some of the problems that we're facing in the world. And especially here on the way back from Korea, when Pope Francis talks about the just war theory and the need for the community of nations to make it apply. And it's interesting to talk about the just war theory since Tom Malotti was involved the last time the just war theory was talked about. But Kerry came out last week and spoke with these very similar words to what the Pope said about that we need to make this a just fight, we need to get a community of nations. He seems to be working assiduously to get a community of nations. And if so, I think that the Pope has helped give some cover to nations that can team up now where they might otherwise do it. I mean, it's real hard for Arab governments to go after other Arab governments. It's real hard to get Europeans motivated to do anything that's difficult diplomatically right now. And but everybody seems to be realizing the threat of ISIS is a threat to humanity and stepping up. And I think the Pope's got a huge role to play in directing that effort. Also, what he said about, I'll get some other stuff, but what he said generally about radical extremists. And if I know if George Bush were in office, he would be doing what he did before, was every time Pope Benedict would speak up, the United States would speak up in a non-coordinated but nonetheless aligned manner and lend its voice to the same principles. And I mentioned that it's very important that the president have interest in what the Holy See's mission is doing, because there's no business activity, consular activities, things like that at the Holy See mission. So when the president's attention is not there, there's really not that much to do, because you can't push a rope. You got to have someone who wants to back you up when you go try to engage the Holy See. And that's why it was so important, President Bush, so important, Ronald Reagan, and all that. But nonetheless, even with points of divergence, there's a lot of important work that we do together with the Vatican that I should make sure to point out. We have one of the most effective anti-trafficking programs in the world is operated by the Holy See Mission in concert with the support of the Holy See. There's a nun over there. Sometime you ought to get her to come speak at a scene called Sister Eugenia. She's about an 80-pound ball of fire against trafficking. And I think at one point she had a price on her head in Italy because she caused so much ruckus with the government of Italy about harboring traffickers. And the people in Bulgaria can't stand her because she's always talking about how many trafficked girls are smuggled out of Bulgaria and things like that. So, and one of the things I got to do when I was there is I would connect her up with all these ambassadors from around the world who had no idea, or like Casablanca, there's gambling going on here. They didn't want to recognize that there's trafficking in their country. So I'd say, Ambassador, Sister Jean, tell them the facts. Ambassador, there is trafficking going on in your country, and here's how you can deal with it. Here's how we want to help you. Covertly, so it doesn't, so it looks like you get all the credit, but that kind of thing. Yeah? We also do a lot of work, of course, the United States being the most charitable nation on earth with disease in Africa. George Bush spent $30 billion through the program called PEPFAR, and we try to align as much of that as possible with Caritas. And, 27% of all AIDS victims are dealt with in a Catholic institution, so there's a natural alignment all through Africa. Spoke with Mrs. Bush, and Pope spoke a lot about that, and because her daughter had actually worked in a Catholic institution in South Africa. The alignment with the United States is a natural, even though sometimes it has been muted or undermined. You know, we're the only two sovereigns in the world that are squarely founded on the principle of the natural rights of man, not rights granted by a state. The only two. I mean, you go all around America, Europe, Dean Bertoli can probably tell you, there's always the thought that there's some kind of grant of the state allowing you to do what you do. And it never gets out of their DNA. Got out of our DNA when we beat Britain, both times. And the other thing is we're the first people to enshrine religious freedom in our founding document. Pope said to me when we were visiting, when I first got over there in 2005, at our credential visit, which is a fascinating thing to get to do, we got talking about America, and he said, America, the First Amendment has been a great experiment that Europe would have been wise to have. He totally gets it. The secular religious state, kind of sounds like an oxymoron, but it's not. Reason and religion coexist, right? That's the idea. And we have made that work in America greater than anyone. So as such, we have a natural alignment to exploit. De Tocqueville in Democracy in America said that he founded the United States in unusual corroboration between freedom and religion. And I think that's playing out as we speak. I might mention there have been three existential threats to the Holy See's diplomatic engagement in the world. First is pretty obvious, Napoleon. Napoleon tried to wipe the church off the map, tried to get he was horrible to Pius VI and Pius VII, but he didn't win. And in 1801, he asked Pius VII to come crown him like the Pope had crowned Charlemagne. And so the Pius VII, smart guy, he realized that he's going to be abused and Napoleon's going to try to use his propaganda victory. He says, I'm going to go anyway. He went, Napoleon abused him, Napoleon had some private ceremony, tried to make the Pope's power look de minimis. Pope spoke right above Napoleon to the people of France. He emerged from that meeting much more powerful than he went in. And as such, it wasn't so long that Napoleon signed a concordat treaty with the Holy See and kind of backed off of his anti-religious, kind of monarchical activities. So that was a big one. Later, the next one was 1870 with Risorgimento in Italy, when the Piedmontese kind of took over there. And You know, after Risorgimento, the government of Italy wanted to eliminate the Holy See's role in the world. And Pope Pius IX refused to let that happen. He even suffered a house arrest where he and his number two confined themselves to the Vatican, virtually, I think, for the rest of their life. And never gave in, never admitted. When you had Metternich, the most powerful man in the world at that time, beating down his neck, never admitted that the Holy See documents were anything less than treaty level, never admitted that the Holy See was anything but a sovereign in the world, and took a lot of guts. I mean, you know, that guy had a pretty tortured papacy. You know, people had real high expectations of him, then real low expectations of him. And this is kind of a yin and yang papacy, really. But I think he finished quite strong. And then the third existential threat is kind of an interesting one, is Vatican II. And I would never have thought of this until I researched the book. And Carlo Carrick, from the Carrick Research, many clerics of Vatican II really just thought the Holy See ought to get out of all this diplomatic business and pay attention to theology and saving souls. Not maybe realizing that you save souls a lot of different ways. Okay? And it was Paul VI that protected him. He had been a graduate of the Diplomatic Academy. It's the oldest diplomatic academy in the world, by the way, 1701. And he defended the Holy See's role in the world in a letter called Solicitudo Omnium Ecclesiarum. It's a very important piece of the life of Holy See diplomacy, where he said the purpose of Holy See diplomacy is to achieve the implementation of great human hopes, peace between nations, and the domestic tranquility and progress of each country. And the reason I always like to say that is because that domestic tranquility and progress of each country and that great human hope, that line is exactly what's in the preamble of the U.S. Constitution. And I'm sure he never read that. I might mention a few milestones of the Holy See's diplomacy, a lot more in the book. And like I said, the book could have been that thick with interesting things that have happened. But mentioned, you know, about the early Catholic prejudice. That Catholic prejudice peaked. If we have any sociology teachers here, they could probably criticize this. I'm pretty sure it's right, but I've seen some graphs where anti-Catholic prejudice peaked with the election of John Kennedy and all those horrible things that the Baptists said to him in Houston before he won a campaign. And after that, it precipitously declines. You know, if you want to call the Pope all the time, find out what to do, and he's a good president, and since then, that's been a whole new era. And Nixon appointed Henry Cabot Lodge to be a personal representative. That's when Carter Wall, by the way, was working for Carter Cook. We did have a second-level diplomatic relationship for a while, but then it went away. And then there have been several personal representatives that I'll mention a few of them in a minute. But one thing I'd like to point out is the interesting role the Holy See played in World War I. It's a lot less known than the role of World War II, because people keep reminding us about World War II by sculpt every day. But in World War I, Benedict XV spoke up right away when it was first starting and said basically he saw this as such an internecine backyard fight that it was going to doom a lot of people and could really accomplish very little, given that these were sovereign nations and they weren't going to go away. And what he said is, we have to return to the status quo ante because nations don't die, they just simmer until they can get revenge. How prophetic was that? We could use that kind of wisdom today as we fight through our problems. Unfortunately, there was a dirty deal that happened during the beginnings of World War I, as the Allies were trying to entice Italy to join the war on their side, is that Italy required as a concession that they keep the Holy See out of the post-war treaty discussions. Therefore, the Holy See didn't have a table at the Treaty of Rome at the end of the war, and I think that was a real lost opportunity. The peace note that Pope Benedict wrote in 1917 is, I'm not a scholar, so I don't know about what plagiarism is, but if you put those two up next to each other, there's a lot of similarities, so let me assure you. And 8 months later, Wilson comes out with 14 points. So I think that the Pope had a direct impact on the framing of the post-war peace, even though the Holy See could not be part of the official process. And that's a real lost opportunity, because who's to say that they might not have been enacted a much more reasonable peace had the Holy See been at the table, making those same arguments, and maybe World War II might not have happened. You just never know. In 1939, after the invasion of Czechoslovakia, Franklin Roosevelt realized the value the Holy See could play right away. He had met Carlo Pacelli just at Hyde Park in a clandestine meeting prior to his becoming president. And among other things that they worked on was he wanted helped to try to cuff Italy around as they were moving fascists. And he also wanted help with Father Coughlin, the populist preacher up here. And so what President Roosevelt did was he appointed a guy named Myron Taylor as his personal representative, who was one of the leading philanthropists and businessmen of his time. It would be like appointing the head of Goldman Sachs or Bill Gates or somebody, a very high level appointment. And what he did was he could leverage the Holy See's neutrality all during the war, and some fantastic things happened. Vatican radioactivity, using the diplomatic pouch to get things to Switzerland. We had diplomats in the Vatican all during World War II working along because of the Holy See's sovereignty. And Taylor, and I put a quote in the book where Secretary of State Sumner Wells made a great quote. He said, "We might as well just work with the Holy See mission because we can't get anything out of the embassy to Rome because Mussolini's got it in Carcolato. You know, he just can't get anything out." In fact, Monsignor Spellman, later cardinal, smuggled out one of the anti-fascist encyclicals, Non Abbiamo Bisogno, to France to get it published because Mussolini closed down all the press. Taylor later led an unsuccessful fight for President Truman to unify all religions in the fight against communism. And there's a great book I recommend it to you by a guy named Will Imboden, who used to be the Bush administration and the National Security Council. He's a great guy. Maybe some of you all know Bill, I don't know. But one of the things that comes out of the book is that a lot of these Protestant sects were cognitively dissonant about whether to take up the fight against communism. Some of them were kind of outright pro-communists. And it's kind of amazing to me. But the one that was steadfast and the one that saw communism home from day one was the Catholic Church as an existential threat to religion. And they never wavered. Pius XII never wavered. Nobody's ever wavered. Certainly John Paul didn't waver. And so you wind up, at the end of the day, with Truman, the devout Baptist, relying on the Holy See to be the sharp edge of the spear in coming after communism. I thought that was a fantastic irony. During the Cold War, there was a very interesting thing that happened in Italy when the Catholic Church really helped start the Christian Democratic Party. And there was a real chance that Italy could have gone communist for anything, you know? They didn't have Franco. They didn't have a De Gaulle. And it was really the first big CIA operation after the formation of the CIA, after the OSS. And they worked parallel with the church to fortify the Christian Democrats. With the famous leaflet drop where they bombarded propaganda all over Italy. They got money through the church to Christian Democrat politicians. Money always works good for politicians here and in Italy, you know. And it was a successful effort. And to this day, Italy's a stable country. In 1961, there was a Jewish fellow named Norman Cousins. He was the editor of the National Review. And he actually, on his own, conducted a clandestine shuttle diplomacy between the Kennedy administration, Khrushchev, and Pope John the 23rd. And I wrote about it in the book. And it started out exchanging these very simple notes like, "Hi," or "Hope you're well." And then they started to grow a little bit into, "I was reading what you were writing," or "Something's happening over here in the world," you know, to just kind of say we're paying attention here. And it culminated on the 25th of October, 1962, the height of the Cuban Missile Crisis, when the Pope made a speech on Vatican radio that was published verbatim the next morning in Pravda, which in diplomatic circles was taken as a sign of the Russians that kind of saying, "We hear you." And I make the argument in the book, that's the initial seeds of detente. That came right out of the Vatican through that shuttle diplomacy. I'd like to mention two things about those previous existential threats, if I might. Is that Pius VII hadn't faced down Napoleon in 1801, and Pius IX hadn't faced down Garibaldi in 1870, the Holy See would have submitted its sovereignty to other countries and would have ceased to be a diplomatic force. That's why they're so unique. And when you hear people in the press attack the Holy See's sovereignty, it's important to be able to defend the role the Holy See's played in the world as a sovereign entity in international law. That's the first thing they try to do. They try to say, 108 acres, can't be much of a sovereign. How about Liechtenstein? Well, the answer is the sovereignty doesn't have anything to do with 108 acres. The sovereignty has to do with the Holy See, the authority of the Pope, the Curia, speaking for the Church, trying to do good in the world, 100 billion three people, and really not just Catholics, but all Christians, and really the whole Judeo-Christian ethic, who share a lot of common values. And the Pope is the one guy at the top of all that can make that argument globally. The modern era of the Holy See, as you know, began in 1983. Ronald Reagan accomplished getting passage through Congress of the master level mission. He sent William Wilson in early 1984 as the first full-fledged ambassador of the Holy See. And I guess the rest is history. You know, the role that Pope John Paul played in undermining communism is very well known. I try to write about it. George Weigel's particularly written everything about it that can be written about it. But I love the part of it in 1979 where he went to Gdansk Shipyard and Jaruzelski's government said that he couldn't go the last minute. They always tried to stop the last minute. And he said, if you don't let me go, I'm going to go to the airport, create an international incident, I'm going to leave, I'm going to denounce you. So they let him go. Well, the rest is history. You can read the tapes, the speech he gave, the incident, and all that. Started the solidarity movement. And what followed from that was, we really worked together with them. And again, not concerted, unaligned. It's always going to be unaligned. We're not going to have the U.S. talk to the CIA, talk to the Pope directly, that kind of stuff. But we're getting money to solidarity. Typewriter deal, everybody knows about it, not heard of the typewriter. We got a lot of typewriters over to them so they can print their own propaganda. The labor unions of the United States sent money to them. The Holy See's over there helping figure out who it needs to go to in a very oblique way. Very non-aligned, but going down the same road. The Pope speaking out forcefully all the time. You know, when he went back in 1983, he shook his finger at Jaruzelski and said, Poland is nothing but one big concentration camp. No public official is ever going to say something that direct, no matter how heinous the action in question may be. Only the Pope can say that kind of stuff, because he's the Pope. And he moved the needle. Just like Pope Benedict, I think when the history's over, I'll get to that in a minute, we'll be shown to move the needle at Reagan's. And the so concerned were the KGB during this time about the power of the Pope and the Holy See, that they had infiltrated the Holy See through some Ukrainian and East German, through some Ukrainian and East German priests. And we had a mole in Poland that was leaking us documents. One document, which I read, is declassified. Well, no, we stole it. It's not declassified. It's our document. But what it said is basically that they were authorized in East Germany and Poland to, quote, use all means to impede John Paul's advancement after he got to be caught in the crack. Now, you know, a lot of people say, use all means, okay? Like, use all means to, I don't know, clean your house. Well, it's different when the KGB says use all means, you know? And I think they were deadly serious. I think if they'd have gotten a chance to do some mayhem, they might well have. But the fact is, they were all over him, and they were so concerned about the Holy See that they spent some very serious intelligence assets deployed inside the Holy See to find out what's going on. In fact, I put the thing in one of the chapter headings of the book, that a quote from Premier Gorbachev, that all that happened in Eastern Europe would have been impossible without the Pope, which is kind of ultimate reflection of why we need their voice. Tom might have mentioned when he was around up here at the 1994 population conference where the Hillary Clinton and the Clinton administration and the African League were uniting, trying to enact some very horrible population policies, euthanasia, abortion, you name it. They were going to run the table. And the Holy See saw this as a communism-level fight, and they went all out. And they actually found some synergy with the Islamic world, because of the Islamic world fundamental attention to human values and life in some of their teachings, and Benazir Bhutto became an outspoken supporter of the Holy See's position. They succeeded in beating it back. When I got over there in 2005, we had the chance to institutionalize the relationship with the U.S. because we had a new Pope. And it wasn't personal, like it was with Pope John and Pope John Paul Reagan. It was just business. It was the Pope and the United States. And Pope Benedict, he put the antipathy to the Iraq war behind. He was very clear the first time I met in the credentialing meeting that it's time to work together, as he said it, for the peace and stability of the people of Iraq. Good luck. But the alignment of Pope Benedict speaking up in the global war on terror was strong, and the president was very interested in how he could help the Pope and what the Pope could do for the world. I mentioned about the other Caritas and PEPFAR things later in the anti-trafficking programs. In 2006, in September, Pope Benedict gave his Regensburg speech. I imagine everybody knows more than I'll ever know about that. But as Secretary Powell used to say, he called out the elephant in the room. And he again spoke more bluntly than any Western leader had about the evil of the use of religion to commit violence, especially 12th century behavior in the 21st century. And he spoke clearly about the reference in the Quran to the command of the prophet to spread the word by sword, hold the evils of Sharia law, et cetera, et cetera. And he was denounced. It was a fascinating time to get in the Vatican because the whole world was pounding down on the little Vatican. And the appeasers were out there saying the Pope overreached. Some were saying he's old and didn't know what he meant. President said, go find out if he knew what he meant. Tell him, don't back off, for God's sakes. This is really good. That's what the president wanted to have. And I did. I went over there and did my thing. But since that time, since facing the elephant in the room, several groups of Muslim clerics, non-radical clerics, have met. And one quote I put in the book is one group of 38 of them said, you know, we don't necessarily like the Pope's metaphor, but we're going to have to find consonance between the modern world and the Quran. And King Abdullah came to the U.S., which is a big deal for a Saudi king to come to the Holy See. And Abu Dhabi undertook diplomatic relations with the Holy See, and et cetera. So, you know, sometimes you got to confront these things to make them to bring it to a fulcrum point. And here just lately, we've had a few iterations of that progress, amplified, I think, by Pope Francis's comments about Syria and about the just war, where Saudi Arabia is starting to call, King Abdullah personally has called on Saudi clerics to denounce terrorism, and the Grand Mufti in Saudi, Abdulaziz, just a couple of weeks ago, told the press in a press release that terrorism has no place in Islam. These are huge statements for people that don't say anything and have let the United States do their bidding for them ever since the founding of the Saudi royal family. I consider that good. Another thing that happened here just last week is the religious minister in Jordan came out and criticized as religiously inspired terrorism. Jordan's having a tough time, so one of the things we really need to do diplomatically is protect Kurds and Jordan. They're the bright lights, in my opinion, in the Middle East. But, and then the third thing that happened is just a few days ago, two dozen moderate United States Muslim clerics met with the Department of Homeland Security, seeing if they could help prevent radicalization of young Americans. I think that's good stuff. So you read all the bad stuff, and there's plenty of it, but there's also some good things. And they all relate back to the Holy See's soft power voice. In fact, one of the things that Jordan religious minister said is he said, we're not going to combat radical Islam, we're going to have to deal with its ideology because we can't beat it militarily. What more strong statement about soft power? So it's really good that Pope Francis finally found his voice in that respect. The other principle of the Holy See diplomacy is this secularism that I mentioned, or as Pope Francis says, materialism in the Western world. And the concept is, I'm not saying I'm an expert scholar, there's so many priests in here that know so much more about this than I do, but I know how it affects human behavior. And the idea is that when you reduce the role of religion in society and in behavior, confine it to a church or something, or a synagogue or mosque, and make it attenuated from everyday life, you tend to have diminished religious freedom over time, you tend to have more barbaric activity over time, and people become somewhat dehumanized. Religion is a civilizing and humanizing influence on humanity. And the church has been all over this from day one. They continue to articulate the risk to freedom and individual liberty from degrading the role of religion, and kind of ties into why they were the first entity to oppose communism. In fact, on September 22nd, 2001, Pope Benedict talked to the German Bundestag, and what he trying to explain this concept, he said basically that the conviction that there is a God gives rise to the idea of human rights, equality before the law, recognition of the inviolability of human dignity in every single person, and the awareness of people's responsibility for their own actions. And I think that really is an important statement that I wish Western nations with similar principles would tie into and tie a fundamental philosophical reason for the role of religion in society. Nothing shows better is synergy when it works well between the U.S. and the Holy See than in April 2008 when President Bush entertained a state visit of Pope Benedict. I put in a lot of this in the book. Their two speeches were totally unchoreographed. And you'd never think so if you put them side by side, because they jive together so well that it showed the natural alignment between the U.S. and the Holy See. And Pope was referring to our founding principles and the self-evident truths of the Declaration of Independence in his speech. And the president's sitting there praising, talking about the Pope, and which is a really good thing in a country with the separation of church and state. Might close here with a few comments about Pope Francis and maybe questions. You know, there's been a lot of misinformation about Pope Francis. One thing, if you go back and look at what he did during the Videla government in the 80s in Argentina, this guy stuck his neck out big time at personal liberty. He's also continually and aggressively spoke out against both Kirchners over the last 13 or so years. So he definitely has a voice when he sees injustice. And I think that his renewed attention to social justice concerns are important because of the issues globalization presents us. But also, it's important because it shows a focus of what can happen in Latin America. Because he's speaking from a Latin American point of view where we have weak institutions, maybe insufficient education, certainly crony capitalism. And I know the Obama administration was quick to apply that to the United States, but I don't think that's really what the Pope had in mind. I think the Pope's speaking to the world. And I think it creates us an opportunity that I spoke with Carly Kirk about for a new re-evangelization of Latin America, both ecclesiastical, which is not something I don't think about at all, but diplomatically. If we get the people in Latin America to, and that's why I've been getting involved in this Latin America thing, get the people in Latin America to demand more of their governments, to demand education, to demand freer competition, to demand opportunity for people, and not be so quick to succumb to the populist rhetoric of a Chavez or Evo Morales, then I think we may be able to have to institute some real democratic progress there instead of just elections. I'm optimistic that Pope Francis could add some real value there. And of course, his comments on social justice are also somewhat turned around because they don't mention the other part he said about people taking responsibility, about the church's continued respect for private property, free enterprise, the essential human dignity that comes from having employment, all those things that go back to where I'm Novarum. The press only picked out on the things they wanted to. But agree with this guy saying he's really given a complete package. And the appointment of Pietro Parolin, where I think many of the people in the room who've been in the Vatican know Cardinal Parolin, shows his intent interest in taking Holy See democracy, diplomacy forward. Pietro Parolin is one of the smartest guys there. Young, brilliant, knows the United States well. I organized for him to attend the Annapolis Peace Conference in 2006, and he distinguished himself among all the secular representatives and everybody else. And also recently, just last week, the Pope appointed Archbishop Filoni as his personal emissary to the Middle East. And I think Archbishop Filoni, who had been stationed in Iraq, is going to be able to have an impact over there in a very clear-speaking way. His first trip to Latin America, I mentioned about the enthusiasm that he brought, both before the election of Venezuela, both candidates came to see the Pope, Maduro and Capriles, shows you the influence. This recent trip to Jordan, Bethlehem, and Israel, this guy kind of breaks the mold. I mean, no Pope's ever gone anywhere but just Israel when they go there, or maybe over to Bethlehem. And this guy starts in Jordan, goes to Bethlehem, hugs up on the security wall, then goes to see the government of Israel, and then goes and meets with the Imam at the Al-Aqsa Mosque. I mean, he just covered the whole gamut. And I think it's very symbolic that he just went over to Albania and spoke of the coalition of Orthodox, Muslims, and Catholics working together in a peaceful governmental architecture. So he really tied a lot of threads together. Now he's going to go to Turkey in November. I imagine he'll do the same thing. I also think that his kind of new world view is really helpful. After living in Italy, no offense, Dr. Dean, Europe's different than us, and I love his candor, and I love the way he's able to do some things that many Italians would love to have done, but might involve a crony or a family relationship that's hard for them to do. But everybody wants the Vatican Bank to be transparent. They just need a little help getting there. So the Pope's coming out here from Argentina, comes in, appoints a commission. They're doing the same things that our banks over here do now: suspicious activity reports, cash accounting, limits on big cash deposits that send up trip wires, all the stuff you do to eliminate bad guys infiltrating your bank. And I might say, from my limited experience with that bank, there are no bad guys from the Vatican and Vatican Bank. There have been a few people who have been co-opted and deceived, and come up and been used a few times. But this will help a lot, just like with the Curia. Now, before the election, Cardinal Worrell said, we need more of an American-style governance instead of these vestiges of monarchical silos. And I think that the Pope's on today. He's talking about reforming the Curia, having more interchange among the curial leaders instead of each one reporting in a silo up to him. These are really going to be important contributions for him to make. So I guess to conclude, the argument is basically the world needs a Holy See, not just religion need that for sure, but they need it in the world of the engagement among states, deploying their soft power, and representing these fundamental values. and that the United States is particularly aligned with Holy See, and that we need them more than ever. So that's the purpose of the book, and that's what I learned being ambassador over there, and I appreciate the chance to be here. Thank you.
So I think we can all establish that wisdom was an appropriate term for your experience and knowledge, and thank you very much for sharing with us. I would like to bring up Thomas Hill, one of our graduate students, to present you with a token of our appreciation.
Thank you.